record, today is Tuesday, November 18, 2014, and the time is now 9:33 a.m. The committee will hear and accept testimony, both oral and written, on the following items. Bill number 391-32, introduced by Senator Tony Adams, Senator Tommy Morrison, and Senator Chris Duenas, an act to amend paragraph 14 of subsection 3101F of chapter 3 of 16 GCA relative to the motorcycle license road exams. Bill number 395-32, introduced by Senator Brent McCready, an act to amend subsection 74108 of chapter 74, title 11, Guam Code annotated, relative to increasing the civil penalties for scrap metal businesses who fail to properly follow reporting requirements as per Guam law. Bill number 399-32, introduced by Senator Rory Respecio, an act to amend subsection 3218, chapter 3, article 2, title 16 of the Guam Code annotated to update the current standards on the sale of old tires. Bill number 404-32, introduced by Senator Brent McCready and Senator Dennis Rodriguez Jr., an act to amend subsection 74103 and subsection 74104, and to add a new subsection 74110 to chapter 74, title 11, Guam Code annotated, relative to establishing mandatory inspection and certification of all non-ferrous metal property prior to a transaction of sale at a scrap metal business. And Bill number 413-32, introduced by Senator Michael Limtiaco, an act to extend the deadline for real property tax exemptions, authorize the use of the taxpayer identification number for real property taxes, and reduce the statute of limitations on the collection of real property taxes by adding a new subsection 24109 and by amending subsections 24204 and 24112 each of Chapter 24, Title 11 of the Guam Code annotated. I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge some of the senators present. To my immediate left is my Vice Chair, Senator Tom Adams. To my immediate right is Minority Leader Senator Tony Adam. To his immediate right is Senator Tommy Morrison. To the immediate left of Senator Tom Adam is Senator Michael Lutiaco. And to his immediate left is Senator Brent McCready. And to his immediate left is Senator Aline Yamashita. We'll go ahead and dispense with the general rules of the public hearing and proceed directly to public testimony. We'll now hear testimony on Bill number 391-32, and I would like to give the primary sponsor of the bill, Senator Tony Adam, the opportunity to offer an opening statement. Senator Adam.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning. Good morning to the general public. Mr. Chair, 391-32 is an act to amend paragraph 14 of section 3101 of chapter 3 of 16 GCA motorcycle licensing road exams. And at the public hearings of bills 22530 and 87-32, the motorcycle enthusiasts testified before the legislature that majority of the severe motorcycle injuries were from driver inexperience and operating a motorcycle that was too large for the operators. And therefore, what we did was we included in Public Law 3252 a provision that required individuals under the age of 21 to wear a helmet while operating a motorcycle, and a limitation on using a motorcycle that is no larger than the one that they successfully passed the road exam. And the problem with that new law is that motorcyclists had to get a new license every time they bought a new motorcycle with a larger engine size, and this would create a bigger burden on revenue and taxations to keep going back and reissuing a license and retesting these individuals. And we found that since the enactment of Public Law 3252 that most states have addressed the issue by defining motorcycle as a two or three wheeled vehicle with an engine size over 150 cc. And Mr. Chairman, I'd like to hear the comments from the public and this bill, and I wait for their testimonies. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Adda. For Bill number 391-32, we have three individuals who have signed up to testify. I'd like to invite them to the table to please join us. Mr. Carl Dominguez, the Director of the Department of Public Works, Mr. Dave Nielsen, and Mr. John Camacho, the Director of the Department of Revenue and Taxation. Gentlemen, I went to school with Dave, so can we let him go first? Dave, go ahead, man.
All right, thank you. First of all, for addressing... Thanks for addressing the issue here. Obviously, from my business perspective, it was somewhat problematic. And a lot of the riders that come to us, and I know that some of the revenue tax folks had spoke with some of the staff at the dealership about how to like quantify the dealership or the CC limitations on a bike, because in reality you can do a lot of things to your bike that like change it officer pull someone over and determine the size of someone's bike because it's not labeled on the bike, no matter what they've done to the bike to modify or customize it. I think, and then the other thing that, you know, hit me after the hearing was just, you can go and, you know, take your motorcycle or your car test and a Prius and then go out the next day and buy a Tahoe, right? And so it was like, you know, to me, kind of the same issue is, you know, if you buy a motorcycle that's 500 cc's and then you want to get a bike that's 750 cc's, all of a sudden now you're penalized. You got to go through this process again, which I think is burdensome on the government to process all these individuals. And then from a citizen and business perspective, it's very burdensome because now you've got to take the time to go do this over and over and over again. So, you know, thanks for addressing the issue. I think that that's a huge compromise. And I think that the reality of the issue that was discussed was that individuals were taking tests on, you know, 50 cc bikes, and then they get out there on, you know, like a, you know, 1,000 cc crotch rocket or, you know, a Japanese sport bike and get out there and they're just going way too fast and they don't know how to control it. From my business perspective, I think that's less of the occurrence within my business, but there's still individuals that were doing that. I think on a larger issue with the revenue tax testing requirements, you know, I think most individuals and the way that the test is conducted with this circle test, it's a very difficult test for most riders to take. And I think, you know, even me, I've been riding for 16 years and, you know, we practice a little thing and train people how to do it. But, you know, the practicality is that it requires you to basically lock up the wheel and make a full turn within this. I think it's a 10 by 10 circle, maybe it's 12 by 12. It's a very difficult maneuver, and it's not really a practical maneuver that anybody takes in any real world situation of riding a motorcycle, and that's a slow speed maneuver. That's something that police officers are trained on quite frequently in like police officer training. The Harley-Davidson Police Officer Academy trains that type of maneuver, but that's for a highly specialized skill, and that's not for everyday riding or something that you encounter or that causes a death in the event of like a motorcycle accident. So I think, you know, with that, if at some point you can address that issue at revenue tax and updating the kind of training requirement, I think that that could be very helpful for, you know, citizens at least learning the skills that they need to ride and improving that testing requirement. I think I don't have the full law here, but I believe within the law you also address the issue with MSF, Motorcycle Safety Foundation training. I think that that's a requirement right now that's impossible for your average citizen to comply with. Really the only qualified instructor on our MSF is a military instructor that's only open to military personnel. So I believe that's still in the law, but I don't have the full law here. But I think that's something that needs to be addressed, because if you can't comply with it and it's part of the law, it makes it very difficult. From our perspective, we've been able to get Harley-Davidson Motor Company to get MSF to allow us to bring that course on island. But there's a burden on our business financially to do that, so be a little bit of time before we can afford to do that, but it's something that we want to do because I think, one, basic training and then advanced rider training is very important for the public. Obviously something we want to offer because we never want to see someone in a motorcycle accident. And then lastly, something that I've kind of thought of and I think makes sense is that, you know, once there are those MSF courses available, either through, you know, my business or other businesses, and hopefully there's multiple players in the market, then someone should be able to take that training certificate, take it up to DMV, and use that as a qualification for their ability to operate a motorcycle, right? So if you've passed all those requirements, why keep the burden on DMV to conduct a written test and then also conduct a road test in this two-step process? If somebody can take the course, get the written, you know, kind of rules of the road education, and then also get the, you know, practical riding experience, it makes sense and logical to me that someone should be able to take that certificate up to DMV, present it, and say, hey, I'm now qualified to operate a motorcycle. So other than that, I know that was very verbose, but I just had wrote down a bunch of notes there. So with that, I'll pass it to the more important people here.
Thanks, David. I just wanted to ask you a quick question. 50 cc or 750 cc, if they're following the speed limit, the amount of control and skills that they would need would be pretty much the same based on your riding experience?
I mean, I'm obviously not an expert rider. I've been riding for several years, but I think that 50 cc would probably struggle to actually ride at the speed limit, quite honestly. It really depends on the configuration of the bike. I mean, some guys, you know, how old the bike is and how it's riding. I mean, old bikes, you know, if you get up to like 40 miles an hour, you start to get this kind of steering head wobble. You know, newer bikes, I mean, you can get up to, you know, 100 miles an hour and the bike will still stay true to straight. So, you know, I think that, you know, it really depends on the road conditions, the skill of the rider. I mean, they're all things that really a rider needs to think about when they're on a motorcycle, right? It comes down to individual rider skill, understanding your bike, and then just doing those pre-safety checks before you get on your motorcycle, right? Checking your mental, you know, state, like, are you tired? You know, are you stressed out? You know, are you fatigued from, you know, whatever else has happened throughout the day? You know, are your tires, you know, well inflated? Are your brakes working? Are your lights there? You know, those type of things. And then what's the conditions outside? You know, going through those kind of pre-safety checks before you ride, I think is what really determines the safetiness of a rider. 150 cc's, 50 to 150 cc's, I mean, I think it's all kind of the same, right? I think that probably, you know, if you're cutting it at 150 cc's, there's actually bikes at 150, so, or, you know, there's bikes that start at 150, so I would probably make the requirement 149, but, you know, I think that's a decision that you guys need to make. But, yeah, I think the level of skill, it really depends. I mean, there's, you know, 1,800, 2,000 cc bikes that won't go as fast as a 1,000 cc bike. So.
But, I mean, because the general issue is about the safety of the rider, if they're following the speed limit, regardless of the size of the engine, then for all intents and purposes, all else being equal, the rider's skill, if they are properly licensed, should account for them being
safe. Yeah, I think that's correct. I mean, the max speed limit on Guam is 35 miles an hour, right? I mean, how many people follow that? Now that's another discussion. But, you know, it's 35 miles an hour. So 35 miles an hour, I really don't believe that, you know, that the determination of the engine size of the bike is a determining factor whether someone gets in an accident. Yeah.
Thanks, David. Carl?
Hafaday, good morning, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Vice Chairman, and members of the committee. Carl Dominguez, the Director of the Department of Public Works. When we received a copy of the bill, I tasked my Office of Highway Safety to do some research into this, and they did. And they found that in the state of Utah, and they could only find it in the state of Utah, they had a tier system for licensing motorbikes. So I printed it, and to give you an example, in Utah, if you test on a 90 cc or less motorcycle or scooter, then you're restricted to a 90 cc or less, and then the 249 cc, if you test on that, then you're restricted to that or a smaller bike. When you get up to a 650 cc and you test on that and pass, then you will be allowed to ride any motorcycle or scooter of any size. And so that was the only state that they could find this tiered system of testing. They did in their research find that Wyoming and Illinois require that motorcycles or motorbikes of 150 cc or above be used for the testing, as would be required by this bill before us. And so based on that research, DPW and the Office of Highway Safety supports this bill. And basically that's it. That's all I have to testify on.
And again, good morning, Mr. Chairman, Vice Chairman, members of the committee. My name is John Camacho. I'm here in support of Bill 391-32. And basically, like the sponsor of the bill, Senator Tornada, it's hard to have these people come in every time they want to increase the CC and take the test. So this is something that is a neutral that we will follow as a road test, and we fully support the bill. Thank you.
Senator Adder, did you have any questions for the panel? Okay. Did any other senators have any questions? Senator Morris.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I first off want to thank the Senator Adder for allowing me to be a co-sponsor of this bill, and I want to thank the panel for being here and provide testimony. Thanks, Dave, for approaching us and to see how we can always improve things and make it a lot more efficient. I just want to ask a question, John, with the 50cc scooters that I think we see a lot out there. How does that process work?
Can these guys actually pick up a 50cc and just go out there and start riding on the road or highways? What type of process is in place for those who are do they just need an operator's license, or do they go through some kind of exam?
You caught me there, Senator.
Yeah.
Basically, I guess in order for basically to get a motorcycle driver's license, there's certain requirements, and I guess currently the requirements under the law basically would basically that you come in and basically if you have an engine, whatever that engine CC is that you take, well basically that's what you're limited to, right? So that's something that as far as the 50cc, I gotta go back and verify that, if I may, and get back to you, Senator.
Could you give us some input on that as well, Mena? Because I think, at least for the committee, I'd like to know how our people are ending up. I know, you know, we're looking at whatever means for transportation out there, and some could be the most affordable thing out there for our people to take. But our goal is to ensure that, as Dave was mentioning earlier, I mean, it's still a safety issue for these folks, and I think it'll be prudent that they still go to the same channels regardless of the size. If it's if it's 50 and they're just issuing an operator's license and no license, or they can actually just be issued something that can go out there with a 50cc. I'd like to see if you would recommend that they also go to the same channels. I'm not sure if that's what's happening right now.
I'm not sure, but I can certainly look into it. I know the tourists are basically they're very fond for, you know, renting, going down to one, renting those 50cc scooters. So I like to look into it and get back to you. I'm just right now I don't know what the current law that, you know, that reads on 50cc and below.
Dave, what's your thoughts? Do you have thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, obviously I don't sell a motorcycle that's under, you know, 50cc. The smallest bike that Harley makes is 500cc's. But I think that, you know, you hit the point on, or you hit the point on the tourist side. I mean, I would be very cautious with that. I mean, I actually think that that's a great thing that's happened recently in Guam, was there's a lot of kind of scooter rentals for tourists, because most of them don't get cars, and cars are expensive for tourists to rent. But that idea of coming to a tropical paradise and getting on a scooter and going throughout Tumon, and some of them head down south and just explore. Most of these guys don't have motorcycle license. Most of those countries that they're coming from to operate a scooter, they don't require a license. So as soon as you put that licensing requirement in place, these scooter operators won't be able to rent scooters anymore. And I think that just hurts, you know, the kind of experience that somebody's coming to Guam for. You know, a 50cc scooter can barely get up to the speed limit, and that's like, you know, with the wind at your back, right? So I think it's really a recreational thing, and there's not a lot of hazards involved in someone operating a scooter. So I would just be careful, you know, touching on that. I mean, yeah, there's a licensing requirement for operating a motorcycle, you know, like one of my motorcycles that in theory could get up into pretty high numbers as far as miles per hour. But I think the scooter thing is really a tourist issue right now, and they're not affected by the licensing requirements. And so, you know, even for us, we rent bikes, but they must have a motorcycle license because of the size of our bikes. As soon as you put that licensing requirement in place, these guys can't get insurance, because unless the people have a license to operate, and you probably effectively kill that industry.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chair. Vice Chairman Adam.
I just have a couple of questions. First, Dave, I don't know what the increments of the engine sizes are, whether they come in, you know, 20 increments of 25cc or what, but you mentioned something in your testimony about maybe taking a look at what that threshold is of 150, that maybe you may want to take a look at, you know, no less than 149, because then if they come in increments of 25cc's or 50cc's, then the guy is going to have to go basically limited to like a 200cc or whatever. So can you elaborate a little bit on?
Yeah, sure. Again, I'm not the expert on all the motorcycles, because again, our small cc is 500, but Yeah, I think it, as you see in the Utah bill, they talk 149 and smaller, because 150 is, right, was it 149?
They have it at 90, 249, 649.
Carl, can you just state that into the microphone? That way it's all on the record.
In the Utah system, they have it set at 90 cc, 249, and then 649. Yeah. And then 650 and above, you can, if you pass that, you can ride any yeah. type of motorbike.
But it really depends on the manufacturer. I mean, some manufacturer, I mean, generally you'll see things like, you know, 150, 250, 450, 500, but there's all kinds of, like, modifications to bikes that, you know, can change that, you know, within a few, you know, 25, 50 cc's. But, yeah, I think, a 150 cc scooter, I mean, can definitely ride the speed limit and is not a small bike, right? I mean, when you're talking 49 cc's, I mean, that's the lawnmower.
Yeah, basically my concern is that if we put threshold at 150 cc, maybe the next increment would be 175 or 200 cc, and I imagine that would be quite a difference in the size of the bike and whatnot.
Yeah, the operation of that bike would
right.
be. Yeah.
So maybe if that threshold was reduced to 149, then probably what's available out there is 150 cc and up. Probably more of an expert in that. But the other part is, I know if I was a first-time motorcycle owner, I'm probably going to go out and look first for a 150 cc bike to go take my test,
yeah.
and then I'm going to turn around, I'm going to go down to your shop and buy a 500 cc
yeah.
bike, maybe. Now, of course, we don't want to burden rev and tax with having to come back every time I want to upgrade to come back and take a test.
Right.
Any thoughts about if then I was going to go out there and get a take the test using 150 cc bike, that maybe I need to I cannot upgrade by so many cc's until after 6 months that I've assuming that then during that 6 months I would have had some more riding time that maybe will make me a little bit more competent in riding a bigger bike. Any thoughts on that? And maybe more really from you, Dave.
I mean, from my perspective, right, I mean, you know, different people learn at, you know, different paces, right? I mean, I've seen guys that have progressed from just learning how to ride a bike to within 6 months. I mean, they're better than some guys that have been riding for years just because, you know, they have that interest in becoming a better rider, like how to turn better, how to have more control of your motorcycle, how to come into turns, you know. So I think that, you know, it's hard, you know, for, you know, to legislate somebody's ability to learn, you know what I mean, to kind of set rules for, hey, you must take 6 months. You know, I think that that's frustrating from a citizen's perspective, and I think just hard to, you know, quantify on paper, right, to contemplate, you know, every scenario. I think that, you know, 150, you know, this is really for the other kind of two-wheel businesses on Guam, but I think 150 is a pretty solid size that someone should be able to take a motorcycle test on, in my personal opinion. I think to try to increment it up, like he had stated, you know, only one state in the entire United States has, you know, this kind of tiering law as is originally contemplated. And then a couple others just limited to one size of motorcycle. I think the way that you guys have drafted it here is smart, because you get into 250, one, the cost to acquire a 250 is significantly more than a 150, right? So I think you limit the access to people that is an affordable means of transportation and a logical means given kind of the climate that we live in. So I think 150 makes sense. I think it's safe. I think that they can operate safely on the road within the speed limit. And I think that starting there and then, you know, however they progress, I mean, people self-select in this type of thing, right? It's like you get on a 150 and you're like, okay, I feel comfortable. I feel more comfortable. I want to move up. And then they come down and they're like, hey, you know, I want this 1200 cc. And they get on and they're like, oh, this is too big for me, right? And when we're, and they have a license and we're kind of walking them through the bike, I mean, we advise them, like, this may be a little big. You might want to step down to, like, 883 until you feel more comfortable moving up to a larger. But, you know, people's lives are in their own hands and operating a motorcycle or a car or whatever, and people self-select, right? I mean, they understand, hey, I'm going too fast or this is too big, right? I mean, it's especially on a motorcycle, they're not going to hurt anyone else but themselves, right? So people are very cautious, and you watch them, you know, on motorcycles, most people are very, very cautious when they're riding a motorcycle. So I don't think that you're going to, I don't think it's logical to try to legislate the time frame in which someone learns.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Vice Chairman Tom Adda, Senator Jekyll.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Dave, you had mentioned something in your prior testimony that your company only sells, the smallest displacement motorcycle was 500cc.
Yeah, actually, in the testimony today, last year the smallest that we sold was 883, but this year it's 500.
It's 500. You know, I'm not aware, and I guess the question is, are you aware of any of the other major manufacturers that sell a bike with a displacement of 150 cc's or less?
I think they're all kind of in that, you know, small cc scooter type realm, so I think 150. Yamaha makes a 150 scooter. I think the Ruckus is a 150.
Yeah, I think that's where I think
the
intent of this law is supposed to go, is to differentiate between scooters and motorcycles.
Sure.
And you know, I'm concerned that I think the smallest displacement, as most manufacturers make, is maybe a 250 cc street bike, as opposed to, I think the 150s are in the scooter range already. I know that in the import market they have those smaller displacements, but if the intent of the law is really to kind of differentiate between scooters and motorcycles, I'd like to know what your take on it is. Do you believe that it should be maybe at the minimum a small displacement size that current manufacturers offer, which I think is around 250 cc's as opposed to 150? What's your take on that from a...
I guess from my perspective, the first two-wheel thing that I rode was a scooter. Right, so that's really where I learned how to ride, because the dynamics of operating it are the same, right? You know, it's like riding a bicycle. You know, you got centripetal force that, you know, keeps you upright while you're going because the wheels are spinning, and you know, the turning, you know, if you push, you actually lean, you know, that type of thing. It's all the same, but it's easier and more accessible to learn from, right? So I think if you take people's ability to learn how to ride a motorcycle completely out of that range. Right, so now they're in the 250 range. 250, you're generally talking, you know, probably a dirt bike of some sort, right? And what's a 250 dirt bike gonna cost you? You know, $5,000, you know, $5,000, $6,000. You know, that's instantly, you know, takes a lot of people out of the market from learning how to ride this logical and affordable means of transportation, right? If you keep it in that 150, you get them out of this, you know, kind of toy range. You know, 49, 50 cc is really a toy. I mean, not in that sense, but it doesn't go very fast, right? It's more for just recreational enjoyment purposes, but it's not like a really logical means of transportation. But that 150 range, you know, it has enough power to get you up to the speed limit. You can keep with the flow of traffic very easily, and you know, it's not too expensive. I think a 150 range scooter, you know, you could probably get for $2,500 or something like that. So $7,000 for $7,000 for a motorcycle is not inexpensive.
Thank you, Senator Lemtiago. Any other senators have any questions for this panel? If none, I'll go ahead and go ahead, John.
I just got some feedback from my staff, Senator Morrison, on the 50 cc. I believe the law requires that if you go below above 50 cc, you need a driver's license, whether it's a moped or a motorcycle. I think that's the current law. So over 50 cc, yeah, you need a driver's license to operate that motorcycle or moped.
So an operator's license.
Operators, yes.
Oh, yeah, so 50 cc, they will have to have an operator's license.
They will. Yes.
They will.
For a motorcycle.
Okay. So and with that information, just to clarify then, so we're saying here that no one can take the qualifying road exam unless they take it with a 150 cc
or larger,
but we require them to get that license if they're riding a 50 cc to 150 cc.
It doesn't really matter. I mean, the law says 50 cc or above, you need a motorcycle. You're just setting a cc standard to take. In other words, you're saying you can't to take the road test, you cannot have something, you know, lower than 150 cc. That's basically what you're saying. But the law still says that you need a driver's a motorcycle license to operate anything above 50 cc. So to me, it doesn't really matter. You're just setting a precedence of what cc really required to take the road test.
Okay. Any other questions from the senators? No. Thank you very much, gentlemen. Really appreciate the input. Senator, did you wish to close on the bill? Or? No problem. We'll go ahead and move on to the next item on the agenda, Bill number 395-32, introduced by Senator McCready. I'll go ahead and yield to the sponsor for his opening statement.
Bill 395-32 is an act to amend 74-108 of Chapter 74, Title 11, Guam Code Annotated, relative to increasing the civil penalties for scrap metal businesses who fail to properly follow reporting requirements as per Guam law. I know there's some indications of amendments by the Attorney General's office, which I am open to, and of course, any public comment that would help ensure that we end this industry on our island. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator McCready. Signed to testify, we have Attorney Phil Tidinko from the Attorney General's office and Captain Castro from the Guam Police Department. General, if you please join us. I guess we can go ahead and begin with Phil.
I can start. Are we going to include 404 too, or they're sort of related?
Whatever the chairman wants.
Yeah, we'll just talk with them one at a time for now.
One at a time, okay. Well, with respect to Bill 395 to increase the penalties on behalf of Attorney General Rapatis and Office of Attorney General, of course, we support increasing the civil penalties. Of course, I think more substantively, 404, Bill 404 together with this bill provides a comprehensive attack on the problems we have with the theft of copper, aluminum, and other non-ferrous metals that, destroy our schools, our homes, and our businesses. So I'll reserve the rest of my comments. They're more for Bill 404.
All right, thank you, General Tidinko.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, honorable senators. I'm Captain Castro from GPD. I'm here to provide testimony to support the bill. Just so you know, since the beginning of this year to August, we've had 58 thefts reported, and we have made 3 arrests so far, which is currently being looked into by the AG's office. And I can't divulge much information, but it may result in a core group doing these things. So we do support it. We do hope that with the amendment that the AG has, it does pass. Just this morning, we did have another theft in Delhi. So this is really taking effect in the community as a whole. So I guess with the body, we can push this forward. And, penalties a lot more stringent on these perpetrators.
Thank you, Captain. Just a quick question, Phil, on the because basically what this bill does is it increases the amount of the fine. Have we assessed fines on businesses at this rate before over the years, or are we having these crimes committed but we're not actually adjudicating it to the point where we're actually assessing the fine?
I do not know whether anyone's ever assessed any fines.
So to your knowledge, you don't recall a fine actually being assessed?
No.
So, and the reason why I ask is because, I mean, I understand the logic of raising the fine as a deterrent, but if we're not even assessing the fine to begin with, then we're not really, I mean, it's not really a deterrent to begin with.
Well, standing alone, but I think together with Bill 404, if we get to that, that's why I was sort of prefacing my remarks that it would would be a comprehensive approach, then it makes perfect sense to increase the civil penalties here, because 404B, Bill 404 addresses the problems about compliance and enforcement, both civilly and criminally. So increasing the fines will logically follow that. Now, if it was just simply Bill 395 and there's no Bill 404, then I'd be wholeheartedly agreeing with you that increasing the penalties does very little if there's very little enforcement or compliance, or there's no additional legal provisions that will give the tools to law enforcement and to the administrative agencies to tackle this problem. And I can go into why I think 404, of course, certainly the author will do that too, so the legislative intent behind it. But yes, you're absolutely right. If it was a standalone, then yes, but it's not standalone. It looks like we've got a comprehensive approach.
Okay, that's actually great testimony, because probably what we'll do is we'll work with the author to perhaps merge the two, assuming that 404 turns out to be something that everybody's comfortable with. Okay,
that's great.
Just so that for the purposes of procedure, we wouldn't want one to pass without the other if what you're testifying to is that both need to be together.
Correct.
Okay. Thank you so much for that. Senator McCready, did you have any closing statements?
Thank you. Well, I just wanted to, I received an email today.
I'm sorry, yeah. Senator McCready, I don't mean to interrupt, but
sure.
I do. Senator Atta has a question, and I didn't want you to do a closing statement.
Sure. Thank you. So I guess what we're talking about here is these are civil penalties that are being proposed. And I guess with civil violations, the AG's office doesn't really need to get involved, right? I mean, the police department can make investigations, arrest somebody, and take it directly to Superior Court. I guess I'm kind of looking at this from the standpoint, if you remember the traffic violation citations, where the judges basically threw it out because the only one that can actually prosecute, because these were, I guess they were subject to misdemeanor or whatever. And so the only one that could press charge, prosecute was the AG's office. And so as a result, a bill was introduced last year, I believe, which made those traffic violations civil violations, so that then the police department can actually go directly to the court, press the charges, and then they take care of it there. So is that what we're talking about here also?
Yes and no, in terms of is that analogous to the traffic situation. I think the civil penalties here, again, when you introduce civil penalties, those are usually handled administratively by the agency that's sort of in charge, that points out the violation. Whenever there's civil penalties, which would be handled administratively, then you have your due process rights under the AAA to challenge it. And then, of course, you could take it up into Superior Court if you don't want to pay these civil fines, separate and apart from the criminal one. The traffic court was a whole different situation. The trouble was Title 16 had many violations that carried criminal penalties. And so when you carry criminal penalties, then there should be a prosecutor, not the traffic court judge acting as the prosecutor as well as the judge. And so that was the issue there. So that's why it's a little bit different. Because some traffic violations carried pure civil or monetary penalties, and others carried both. And whenever you carry a jail time penalty, then that should be handled in the criminal court context. So that's why that was done with those rules. So civil penalties can be handled through the AAA and then up into Superior Court, and that's the only difference. Of course, and there's a different burden of proof. So I don't think that what we necessarily run. In fact, I'm quite surprised that nobody proposes criminal penalties, because at least for the last 20 years, I know that the laws have been that they always add criminal penalties to these type of violations, but we're able to handle it under Title IX also without having criminal penalties put on here too. So I don't see that as a problem. With regard to the civil penalties.
So I guess the point of my question is I know that the workload of the AG's office is I guess quite high. I mean, that seems to be the perception. And that if then, you know, we the police arrest whatever scrap metal operator whoever's involved, I'm concerned about the fact that because these are considered criminal violations, or I don't know if they are, that if it has to go to the AG's office to then, you know, finally bring it to its next step, then we're going to get that nothing happens because, given the resources that you have and the demands for those resources, you know, do you spend your legal resources to prosecute somebody who's basically in cahoots of selling these scrap metal, or do you spend your resources to prosecute someone who may have, you know, fatally injured somebody else? And it seems that the latter would probably take priority. So as a result, these cases seem to just languish.
Okay, first off, that's not the case, that these cases languish in terms of, there hasn't really been a prosecution of a scrapyard dealer. I mean, not that I know of, yet, in a while, rather. So, and that's handled under Title IX crimes, you know, basically your theft by receiving, crimes against the community, et cetera, their conspiracy. So we can handle those under Title IX. So if there's a criminal probable cause, this civil penalty is separate and apart from the Title IX violations that could be occurring. And certainly, we would, as we get to 404B, I would tell you that the incentive, I mean, might as well jump into it. The incentive for these folks, besides probably having drug problems, is that they can sell this metal to support whatever habits they may have. So we would prioritize the source that's incentivizing these folks to continue their theft and ripping off and rendering dysfunctional our schools and our homes by stealing our metals, our pipes, you know, keeping us from having electricity or water pipes, or like my mother's aluminum shutters were all stolen, so we got to go replace them with. The point, I think, is those prosecutions don't languish, because the difficulty has been we don't have the tools to gather the evidence to prove beyond a reasonable doubt. But Bill 404 does address that. In working with the senator, we believe that 404, because right now the onus is put on who? The current law says the dealers have to do all their registration. Well, if nobody's going out to inspect the dealers, then how do you, especially if the dealers are in on it, how do you de-incentivize? If I drive up with a truck full of stuff and the guy that I'm selling it to doesn't bother to follow the law and no one bothers to inspect him, then how are we supposed to stop this? Well, 404 addresses that because it says, as costly and onerous as it is that when I drive up with that pickup, I got to get my photo taken by a third party, whether it's revenue and tax or outsourced entity, kind of like when you get your car inspected, you can't get a registration without getting your car inspected. Well, you shouldn't be able to sell this stuff without providing law enforcement the evidence we need to do to show and de-incentivize the theft, the thief and the burglar. Because I tell you, he's not going to want his picture taken and fill out that declaration and all of that stuff and have the evidence photographed, because if you leave it to the dealer, I mean, you know, what if they're unscrupulous or just lazy or negligent? Then where's the evidence? How do we stop it? So I think 404 is at least a great attempt to try to address that from the front end as well as the back end. And it is kind of costly, time-consuming, but if you want to stop it, you got to be able to stop that guy from driving up there with a truckload of stuff that's probably going to get chopped up anyway. You know, he's going to think twice. So I agree with you, but that civil penalties standing alone are not enough. But I think if you want to try to address it and give law enforcement the tools to de-incentivize this on the front end, don't leave it with the people who are all making
For example, a school was victimized by 1,000 feet of copper wire. And the following day, a person comes to scrap another yard with 1,000 feet of copper wire. There's no process that requires that person to tell the business owner where that came from. But yet the day before, headlines is that 1,000 foot of copper wire was stolen from the school. So I agree with the AG that there needs to be a process in place to have that seller provide up front where these items came from. And right now, that's not the case. They'll just buy that 1,000 foot of wire, yet knowing 1,000 foot of wire was stolen from the school the day before. So that should be, or I'm hoping it's in the law to include these civil penalties, because it does help the department or law enforcement when we can further question these people as far as where this came from. So hopefully that would address some language into the current law if amended.
Thank you, Senator Hatta. Senator Morrison.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I agree with you, Attorney General, to try to de-incentivize this, but I'd like to get your thoughts on trying to go into the forefront of all this where it actually occurs. And, you know, even look at options of seeing that. I saw that there's inspection requirements or potential rules and regs that will address how the inspections will be done, but what's your thoughts of, we know, I mean, these are high-grade copper wires that they're going after. I mean, schools, sports facilities, these are high-grade type of copper wire they're going after. What are your thoughts that, I don't know if you need to be here or address maybe to the rules and regs, that this has to be not only certified by Reverend Tax, but by a master electrician. I mean, these are major operations they can place to undertake removing those wires, and very risky. But obviously, you know, to make even disincentivize it even further, I think, you know, these folks who are planning these operations will have to have a master electrician.
Senator Morrison, if I may, we're still on Bill 395. What we'll do is I'll amend the agenda first to go right into Bill 404. And I want to afford the sponsor an opportunity to at least close on Bill 395, because the question is more relative to 404. And it looks like we're starting to
overlap
a little bit on the discussion.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Do you have any questions specifically to 395, the raising of the penalties?
Okay.
Any other senators have any questions with respect to Bill number 395 regarding the penalties? If none, Senator McCready, may close.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And because we brought up the cost analysis and the civil penalties, I just wanted to touch on the latest data that shows between January and August of this year, we've lost $126,000 to copper wire thieves. It costs us about a little over $2,000 in incidents, and we have 58 total copper wire burglaries, with the top village being deadly to at 21. I guess after today, that would increase to 22 or 23 with the last couple, over the past couple of months. So that's $126,000 of copper wire theft. That's a lot of money in less than a year. We're talking about six, seven months. So the second highest is Jigo at 6, and then we have Tumuning at 5, and then there are 10 villages: Asin, Maina, Inarahan, Santa Rita, Umatic, Orta, Ganya Heights, Piri, Sinahanya, and Tumon, who don't have any reported copper wire thefts. So I think it's important to know that every day we allow this to go forward, the revenues that we do lose exceeds the revenues that we could possibly gain or use those resources for something else. So thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Senator McCready. We'll go ahead and conclude the hearing on Bill number 395, and at this time I'll go ahead and amend the agenda for us to be able to move directly to Bill number 404, introduced by Senator McCready and Senator Rodriguez. And this is the same bill that was being referenced to in the testimony of Bill number 395. Senator McCready, I'll go ahead and allow you to make an opening statement on Bill 404.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Bill 404-32 is an act to amend 74-103 and 74-104, and to add a new 74110 to Chapter 74, Title 11, Guam Code Annotated, relative to establishing mandatory inspection and certification of all non-ferrous metal property prior to the transaction of sale at the scrap metal business. Now, Bill 404 requires that all these metals be certified by DPW before it can be sold at a scrap metal business. Upon inspection, individuals will be provided a certification of inspection. Now, no scrap dealer can purchase any metal without obtaining a copy of the certificate for their records. Government officials can request to see these certificates and other paperwork at any time. Now, this, as we said earlier, works with Bill 395, which increases the civil penalties for businesses who don't follow reporting requirements. It is a second step to decrease and hopefully eliminate this industry completely from our island. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Senator McCready. With respect to Bill 404, we had Attorney General, Attorney Phil Tidinko signed up. Did you have anything new to add to 404 in particular, or do we just want to open up the dialogue with respect to the bill? Is the microphone on? I'm sorry.
Chief Deputy Phil Tidink on behalf of Attorney General Plavis and Office of Attorney General. In a nutshell, our office has been working with Senator McCready and other senators who have discussed this several months back. As you know, this the rash of copper wire and other non-ferrous metal thefts are impacting our community, and so we sat down to try to brainstorm and take input from both law enforcement as well as from our prosecutors. You know, what are some of the tools that may not only help us to prosecute this, that is by providing us the evidence necessary to prove beyond a reasonable doubt, or even administratively by preponderance of evidence to impose the civil penalties. 404 begins, at least in our minds, to address that as it's designed, and also to have a preventive effect, is to address the issue up front. What is the incentive? If the current law only provides an honor system requiring the scrap dealer and the sellers to be honorable and disclose and fill out all the forms, take photographs, and so forth. Well, there are two problems with that. That doesn't occur, number one, and number two, there's no inspection of it. So there's no incentive for all those two parties to stop. And so we believe that 404 begins to address it up front by requiring, almost analogous to what you do for your car registration, you must get a safety inspection. So one concept, and if someone has a better concept or similar, that's okay too. One concept is to require those people who try to sell these metals, there certainly may be some legitimate folks who do it, those who actually tear down buildings or so forth, but I challenge people to show me how many buildings are being torn down that has all kinds of metals like this available, when in fact we get the reports of the burglaries and thefts and the ripping out of wires and pipes from schools and businesses and homes. And so tackling it up front would require those people who want to sell these metals to get the mandatory inspection and certificate. And it's at that point, and this is not with the scrap dealers, this is with a third party, whether it's, and this statute identifies Department of Revenue Tax. If you think that perhaps that's where Senator Morrison was coming from, somebody who has a sort of related expert field, electricity, perhaps you want to include DPW, or else you do it through the regs, however you want to develop the inspection specs for that. The concept is that person would have to get that certificate of inspection from this third party, whether it's revenue and tax or an outsourced entity. And they would have to meet all those requirements. They would have to get their photograph. They would have to, in fact, I was going to say we need to amend part of the, I think I better say while I remember it, that requirement of the photograph. Not only photographs of the items, but photographs of the statute should, the bill should include also photographs of the individual who has brought the metal or items in, as well as to fill out all those forms and make those declarations. That that in itself also serves the other purpose of providing evidence in the event that we that person comes in on a date certain and we have a report of a burglary involving these types of metals. So we can try to put those cases together better. Plus, we'd also have photographic evidence of these metals, because by the time it gets to a scrapyard dealer, you know, it's mixed, it's stripped. We're unable to determine where it came from. And so we think these are, this is one way to begin to address the problem, provide the evidence to help law enforcement, as well as to de-incentivize the thief or the burglar from coming up there. Now, can somebody figure out a way to break the system? Perhaps. But right now, we have no way to take the incentive away from the thief and the unscrupulous or sloppy or negligent dealer from not taking documents, photographing, and recording, and there's no one inspecting these places. So this is perhaps one way that we're trying to think outside the box, attack it from the front end. And I think this bill begins to do that by its proposed adding of section 74110, the mandatory inspections. I'd also like to, from our office, we'd also submitted to you folks a possible amendment we think would also help with, and I've passed it around, to add a 70 GCA section 74111A, non-ferrous metal purchase and receipt ledgers. We believe that these ledgers will help in also tracking and being able to prosecute these by keeping the dealers honest. And so we'd ask you to consider those amendments. I won't go into some detail of giving it to you. Also, we've also provided for an automatic suspension of their license too if there's no compliance. Again, you got to take the incentive away to be dishonest with purchasing and selling these metals off island. It's apparently a great incentive. And so we propose these amendments as one way to keep everybody in the industry honest about this. Yes, it may, no one likes to regulate the heck out of businesses, but this is impacting, this is a crime against our community. So we've got to do something to make these folks be honest and not take and purchase these metals that are that obviously come from burglaries. Because I challenge people to show us where are these. This is not like some giant cities where there are whole areas abandoned where you strip it. I mean, I saw a special about in the Rust Belt where, you know, there is an industry going on there and China's buying it because they have all these abandoned factories, but we do not have that here. So where are they getting this metal from? From our schools, our businesses, and our homes. By and large, there are not that many, abandoned factories or buildings where these go. So I think this bill is a great bill, and I ask you to consider the amendments we've submitted. These came from our prosecutor saying this will help. This will help reduce this if we have these tools for law enforcement. And so, again, I urge you and ask you to support Bill 404. I think it's a good beginning because the law as it stands really is not enforceable. The honor system contemplated by the current statute clearly does not work, and the evidence is in the headlines. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief Deputy Filtenko. I have a number of questions. When I look up the definition of non-ferrous metal, it basically states that it's metal, including alloys, that does not contain iron in appreciable amounts. And so what comes to my mind is aluminum recycling and the recycling of these cans, that students do during, senior drives to be able to recycle and raise money for the senior class. Are they going to have to go through this inspection process also with all their bags of aluminum cans? And that's just a process question that I have, but more so on the process itself, and I kind of wanted to ask the Director of Revenue and Taxation to please join us at the table to give us an idea of what the costs will be to implement a program like this, where we're going to have a whole new inspection process and an inspector hired. And there is also a question I have with respect to monetary value of all the property? I mean, how are we going to be doing all of this? And what is all of this going to be costing us? And in the end, if this hurdle plus the penalty is going to just discourage scrap metal dealers from buying copper wire from anybody, shouldn't we just prohibit the transaction of copper wire in the scrap metal business? So I guess we'll start from the beginning. If I could ask the Director of Revenue and Taxation to please join us, so we can get an idea of what the cost and capacity is of the agency to be able to implement this kind of a program. John, if you may join us. If you could just at least stay on the record, whatever your situation may be.
Right now, Mr. Chairman, we're still looking at the bill, and right now we don't have any conclusion how, you know, you're asking what the cost will be, but I think in later we have at least 10 days to submit anything. So at that point in time, we will submit a written testimony.
Okay, I look forward to it, John. Thank you. Captain, you mentioned that there have been 58 thefts over the last, since the beginning of the calendar year?
Yeah, from January to August.
Have these all been copper wire thefts?
No, 39% were copper wires, 36% aluminum, and 24% other metals. That's the current breakdown between January to
39% copper, 36% aluminum, and the other one was?
Metals, various metals.
What was the percentage of that one?
24%. I can send you analysis of our stats on these thefts. But if I can't bring up...
Of the copper, how much of that was wire?
It's all copper wire.
All wire.
Based on that category.
Now, and I guess I wish GPA would be able to answer this, but I mean, aside from thieves selling copper wire, who else sells copper wire out in the market to private scrap dealers? Because when I was speaking of electricians, for example, someone mentioned to me that if they have even just 6 inches of wire, they keep it, you know, because they're able to put every bit of copper wire to use. And so the only ones that will be coming in selling spools of wire are people who aren't in the actual electrician business.
Right.
So maybe if we just prohibited the selling of copper wire to those who are licensed to do business as electricians, we can just eliminate entirely the market for copper wire and wipe out 39% of these non-ferrous metal sales.
That's another angle I agree with.
The reason why I'm asking these questions is because, you know, this whole bill is creating a process that is going to be, we're going to hire somebody, we're going to hire somebody to be able to appraise metals, and then we're going to take all these pictures and create all these records, and who's going to reconcile these records? But maybe if the market is to just shut down, you know, the selling of copper wire, perhaps that's something, you know, a direct approach, unless it's being sold by someone who's licensed to do business as a certified electrician, you know. So I just kind of wanted to pose that, but I do appreciate also, for example, the aluminum question there. That's probably a separate issue that we can tackle. But the whole thing that's kind of spurring us being here today is the copper wire thefts at the schools. I mean, of course, there's thefts of aluminum shutters that people complain about, but the really large issue we're trying to tackle here is the copper wire thefts at the schools. So with respect to that, maybe we can work on a different angle to tackle each of these individual problem areas, copper, aluminum, and other metals. But on the copper side, I think we might talk with the sponsor and see if we can come up with a different approach. But I do appreciate the testimony, and I would like to turn it over to the panel if they have any other questions as well for the body. Vice Chairman Tom Adams.
I like the concept of the bill, although I do question, you know, if the government is going to take on the burden of certifying and doing all the inspection and all that, is Revenue Tax really the agency that should be tasked with that, as opposed to GPD, who probably would be more in the know of, you know, what's been reported within the last 24 hours. So. That one I do have a question on, you know, with regards. I mean, I don't know how we ended up selecting Revenue Tax to do that as opposed to GPD. The second concern that I have is I don't see why the government should have to bear the cost of certifying where these things came from. Maybe the seller should bear that cost. So we have companies out there who are third-party inspectors. That's what they do for a living. And they live on their reputation. So you got companies like SGS, you got companies like Island Certs, and I imagine there's probably other companies who get hired to go out there and do the necessary inspections. And if there's something in the bill here that says then they must also kind of quantify how much. So if the guy drives up with a pickup truck off copper wire and it's assessed at a value of $1,000, maybe that seller should bear the burden of paying 10% of that to get that certification through. But why should the government, I mean, the revenue tax is already tapped out, GPD is, maybe that seller should be the one to bear that cost. And I don't know if anybody has any thoughts about that, but the bottom line is that that truckload of copper wire needs to be certified, and maybe the seller should bear that burden.
Well, that seller with the material, he's generating income, and you have to report income. And there goes a license. He could attain a revenue tax. This generates money for the government on his dime for hopefully getting that appropriately. So that could be a way to generate funds for the government if he gets a license, because he's generating income. We all have to report income. I'm not a tax person, but I don't know the amount that's required to attain before you get a license. But again, the onus is on them again.
I think the bill tries to address putting the cost on the seller by charging a fee for getting that certificate of inspection. So I don't know whether you recover entirely the administrative cost on it, but it does contemplate a fee and putting some of that, not that the government absorbs it entirely. And I believe this bill, if I recollect the language, does try to address your concern, which is the government shouldn't bear the total cost of it. So again, that would be another disincentive for a thief, burglar, druggie to pull up with stuff he just ripped off, and he's got to come up with the money. You're absolutely right. So it's already contemplated, and so the costs wouldn't be borne 100% by the government. And if you prohibit it, we prohibit a lot of things. That's all I'll say. We prohibit drugs. We prohibit. That doesn't stop it. There's a market. There's a worldwide market, gentlemen. I think prohibiting it, the sale of it, does not address things. When humans need money to pay for things, and there's a worldwide market that's almost as good as gold, this is. But there's a market for it.
But my point is even if there's a provision in the bill where the seller is going to have to pay a fee to whichever government agency is going to do the inspection, the problem is that, revenue tax, for example, is already spread thin as it is, and as a result, that's why we have long lines, to take the driver's test or whatever, or long lines to receive other services. Now we're going to add on that one more and spread them even thinner. So maybe the next best thing is let the private, go out in the private sector and hire one of those third-party inspectors.
And the statute does permit whatever entity, whether you want it to be revenue and tax, GPD, or the Department of Public Works, to outsource it. It does provide that. The language in this bill also contemplates that perhaps whichever agency you believe is appropriate, which you could amend. It's revenue and tax, which just as identified as one possible agency to regulate this. If it happens to be DPW or GPD, they can outsource this, and so that would let the private sector, just like we do with the inspection stations. Before it was the government, now the inspection stations run it. I'm not saying this is a panacea. It's just it's an idea offered to think outside the box about how to begin to address it, and it's not without cost.
And that's fine. I wasn't aware. I hadn't read the bill thoroughly to know that there's a provision that would allow revenue tax to be able to outsource it the way they do with the vehicle safety inspection stations or the license examinations and whatnot. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Vice Chairman. Do any of the senators have any questions? Senator Morrison. Okay, thank you. I was actually trying to get at, I think Carl just stepped out, but again, we have some systems in place or models or that are in place that handle
handle is, for example, you know, before you can even build a home, you know, you have to go get a building permit to that process to even occupy it. You know, of course, you have to go through certain procedures to inspections, of course, and to address occupying your home. Carl's here, but, you know, do you envision this as similar to something where you will have to, and we're talking about the forefront, before you even want to engage in trying to obtain that copper wire or metal, we're talking copper wire, you will have to have some type of permit to obtain, go after that, and have those documents revealed. I'm just saying there's some processes that are already in place. And I guess if you're coming up to the dealer, that you will have to something similar to an occupancy permit, that you have all the checks that were cleared after erecting or removing those copper wires down to the master electrician. Do you envision that same type with these type of rules and regs that would develop something like that?
Senator, I'm not certain I quite follow, but I the concept here again is whether you require, whether you put this with DPW, because I guess they have electricians and engineers who might be able to be the proper, or whether you require that entity, the outsourcing, the third party inspection station. Again, that's also, I was going to add here that, you know, the, because he has it, for example, in subsection H of 74110, that's the outsourcing language. I was going to put, I have some language I was going to include requiring the procurement and to have the proper specs. The point is, you can require that third party inspection station. Heck, you guys could put amendments and buddy this up with the darn vehicle inspection stations, however you want to do it. You know, we can think outside the box here. To outsource this, you can require in that procurement that they have electricians who are familiar with whether this is truly copper from wires that belong to schools or whatever. The purpose here of this bill, as I understand it, is to address the problem up front and de-incentivize. The honor system right now is that, you know, I'm supposed to be honest and drive up there, and the dealer's supposed to be honest and say, you know, yeah, you got that from a good place, and I'm going to take your picture, you're going to fill out the declaration, all that. It doesn't happen. And then someone's going to go and inspect it. That doesn't happen. So whether you have electricians, and also I wanted to get back to Senator Sinicla's questions about the recycling. You can write that out. You know, aluminum cams are exempted, or however. I mean, I don't know. I'm not an engineer, so we probably have to have those kind of folks who have and the people in the recycling to make certain that we exempt them. But what we're really talking about here is people who drive up with these wires and these metals, and then what happens is they get chopped up and stripped, and so there's no way to identify them and to prosecute these cases. So,
yeah, what I'm seeing here is, I agree. What I'm seeing here is it's kind of like after the fact, the inspection takes place, and certifying these items are were done properly. What I'm trying to get at is, even for those who even wanting to attempt this, will have to scratch their heads, because they would have to require also providing some permit that allowed him to do this in the first place.
It is kind of like that. It's
okay.
You know, so when I got my truck full of stuff I stole, mm-hmm. I got to drive up to this third party or to whatever agency and get a certificate of inspection, and then that dealer can't accept it. By the way, a duplicate's being sent to GPD or the AG's office, which is what this contemplates, so that in the event there's a theft that occurs or burglary, we can be able to try to line this up, part of our investigation, and be able to say, okay, now who's the suspect here? Because nine times, you know, the way we break these cases is only because we bust somebody on something else and they say, hey, I'll give up some people. Well, you know, that doesn't prevent this from occurring. So what this bill tries to do is also provide a preventive measure. Mm-hmm. And so, as well as a law enforcement tool for all of us. So, but But yes, it is kind of onerous. Yes, no one likes to regulate industries, and so it's a policy call.
Okay.
You know, do we want to put in a measure that is preventative, or do we want to keep the current law, which calls for an honor system, and dishonorable people don't follow the honor system?
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Senator Morrison. Any other senators have any other questions? I just had one quick one for the police department. Have we ever, you know, we've caught copper wire thieves before? Have we ever had them inform the police department who they sold their scrap metal to?
Yes, yes, and we're working on that. We currently have a task force of other agencies working with GPD. As a matter of fact, that's with the AGs now, and they're contemplating owning up to other people and helping themselves. So yes, the system allows us, when we do catch them, when they want to plead and provide info to get other people.
I know that in order for you to be able to retain your business license, you have to follow the laws of Guam. I mean, I don't see why these businesses just don't have their business licenses immediately revoked for having receiving stolen property and having facilitated in the transaction of these thefts. So, I mean, I know there's already laws in the books for us to be able to, once identified, begin imposing penalties on these companies.
Right.
So, you know, I would encourage that the agencies work together to take what's already on the books too and make that work to the best effect possible, so these companies can understand that, you know, 58 instances of theft with 39% of them being copper wire, clearly, those companies should be shut down, or a penalty should be assessed, or both, you know, because if they're knowingly taking these stolen properties and profiting off of criminal activity that's hurting our kids, and they're still open for business, I mean, that's like a triple slap in the face.
Right.
You know?
Senator McCready, Nicholas.
If I just may add, Senator Nicholas, you're absolutely right what you just said. In fact, one of our amendments states that failure to comply with the ledger requirement shall result in automatic suspension of violating the scrap metal business license for 90 days. So we're proposing amendments to try to tackle what you're just suggesting among our amendments, because that was a gap we also saw. Thank you.
Thank you.
And Senator Chairman, was it's a perfect segue into my last question, which would be, when we talk about the 58 thefts, out of those 58 thefts, would you say that most of them resell the property that they stole?
Yes, that's the main agenda.
Okay, so maybe 100% of them. So yes. That 50 turns into 116 now, when you talk about just the crime, because the crime doubles from the stealer to now the person who is purchasing.
Right.
And out of those 116 crimes now committed, how many of those do you think get shipped off island?
Again, I don't know who profits from that here on island.
But there's the possibility that there's three crimes in one here.
Right, the stealer,
the buyer, and then the shipper, correct?
Correct.
So we're looking at a possibility of 174 crimes that for one industry.
Right, but then the consequent is there's money to purchase drugs.
Yeah.
And then it's just a cycle.
Okay, so that was my last question. It's just not one crime that we're looking at. We're looking at three crimes for an industry that really doesn't have a spotlight on it to combat it. So that's something that I think Senator Nicholas hit on too. When you're getting slapped in the face three times,
right.
We're getting slapped in the face, you know, three times in 174
many
crimes.
Times over, right.
Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator McCready. If there be no other questions, thank you, gentlemen, for participating in the hearing on Bill Number 404. We'll move on to the next item on the agenda. It's Bill Number 399-32, introduced by Senator Rory Respecio, an act to amend Subsection 3218, Chapter 3, Article 2, Title 16 of the Guam Code, annotated, to update the current standards on the sale of old tires. Senator Respecio is currently unavailable to join us. However, we did commit in the committee to move this bill forward, and if I may be afforded a moment here, I'll just go ahead and read the first section, the legislative findings and intent of Bill Number 399-32 for Senator Respecio. The legislature finds that Public Law 29-120, which established restrictions on the sale of old tires in 2008, should be updated to reflect standards established by the U.S. Department of Transportation and to better meet the requirements of consumers while maintaining adherence to a reasonable standard of safety for the use of these tires on public roads. With respect to Bill Number 399-32, we do have four individuals who have signed but to testify today. Mr. Carl Dominguez from DPW, Mr. Vincent Cabrera, Mr. Jeff Jones, and Mr. Mike McCarley. If you may please join us at the table. I'm just in receipt as well of a statement from Senator Respecio that he has transmitted to the committee that I would like to read into the record, so if you please allow me to. The sponsor statement for Bill Number 399-32. In March of 2014, the U.S. Department of Transportation published the summary of the results of National Highway Traffic Safety Administration's tire aging tests that include testing on new light vehicle radial tires. In this study, new tires were submitted to overaging in order to simulate the effects of aging on the elements and structure of tires over time. This process was designed to damage the test tires in the same way that they would be damaged when operated on U.S. mainland highways, where tires are subject to long distance and high speed operating conditions far more severe than what can be achieved here on Guam. Based on this data, the NHTSA concluded, quote, at this time, the agency does not believe it necessary for motor vehicle safety to add a tire aging requirement to its light vehicle standard, end quote. While tire aging can affect the life and performance of light vehicle tires, technological improvements to manufacturing tires allows us to extend tire aging limits. Tire manufacturers follow the NHTSA uniform quality grade standards that were originated to provide consumers with useful information to help them when purchasing tires. Tests are conducted to grade tires, and because of these ratings, manufacturers have increased the overall level and quality of tire lines. Additionally, all new light motor vehicles released must be equipped with TPMS, tire pressure monitoring system sensors, due to the influence tire pressure has on vehicle safety and efficiency. By increasing the standard to 10 years, consumers will be able to maximize the usage of their tires while maintaining an adequate safety standard. Those most affected by Guam's current law are consumers that can least afford to buy new tires but are forced to by law. Flat tires are a fact of life for everyone. It is unfortunate that tire dealers on Guam must refuse service and force vehicle owners to purchase new tires even when their current tires are in well-cared condition. Thank you for this opportunity to comment. I respectfully request this statement be included with your committee report on Bill Number 399-32 COR. Very truly yours, Senator and Majority Leader Rory J. Respecio, the author of Bill Number 399-32. Gentlemen, thank you for joining us today. I see we have three individuals in the private sector and one from the government, so we'll let the government go first. Carl.
Half a day again, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Vice Chairman, and members of the committee. Carl Dominguez, Director of Public Works. Yeah, we saw this bill, was copy was sent to us, and again, I tasked my Office of Highway Safety to do some research into it, and that research is right here in this binder, and I confess I didn't read the whole thing. It's quite lengthy, but I did take the March 2014 I'll call it NHTSA, for National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, their report on light vehicle tires. And it's true, what you just read from Senator Rory Respecio is, you know, it's in here. It does, the report does state that, and if I could read it for you, NHTSA does take the position that in the warmer parts of the United States where we have data, including Arizona, Florida, Texas, and Southern California, there appears to be a relationship between the age of the tire and the propensity of the tire to fail. The tire aging failures tend to appear in the high heat states in the summer months during the day while the vehicle is being driven at highway speeds. All these factors make it more difficult for the tire to dissipate heat. Heat buildup is the main factor in these types of failures. In Guam, we are tropical. We are hot 365 days of the year. Even in the southern hot states of the United States, there are, during the winter months, they do get cold. Florida has cold spells, and the citrus gets damaged. Those are the examples. But I think the key, when I thought about this, I thought the key on Guam is that the a couple of things is, one, our top speed limit is 35 miles an hour. Okay, we don't drive long distances, as you know. So I came to the conclusion that we for Guam, DPW and the Office of Highway Safety could accept the fact that the new tire tests and the conclusions that NHTSA came up with would justify our supporting this bill. So we are supporting the bill.
Okay, so you're safe amongst the three. We'll go ahead and just move down the order of who signed up here to testify. Mr. Cabrera.
Have a day, Mr. Chairman, Vice Chair, Senators. My name is Vincent Cabrera. I'm the General Manager of MGT Corporation. And I've been like to submit my written testimony. But the key facts I just wanted to narrow in on is the fact on the mounting in the penalties. It says that it mounts on a vehicle as a violation and then is a third degree felony. This is a big concern for us because of the fact that we have been in this industry for 27 years, and we have a range of customers, from people who have classics that have tires that are stored in their house. They only use it for Sunday rides, or they only use the car even for four or six times a year. Bikes, you know, the Harley Davidson bikes, how many miles they have on it, and they store their vehicles. Majority of the vehicles that we see are tire repairs. Tire repairs come in, we have to dismount it, and then when we fix it, we have to remount it. So with that law, because of the penalty, where it states that if we mount it, we're violating the law. These, you can say if it's 6 years, 10 years, but we're still gonna get those older tires that still need to have a repair on the tire. We deal with the different associations, the Drifting Association, the Autocross Association, the Drag Association. These people just need tires just to play with, just to have their fun with their vehicles on a controlled area, and we have to dismount those. They just want a used tire to bring in. We have to mount it for them just so that they can use. Again, we're in violation of the law. Most of all the experiences that we're gonna have is that for elderly people that just want to put a spare tire on because it still looks new and they have a problem with the spare, nine times out of 10, the spare tire is a steel wheel and they want to put the same wheel that they have in the car to match. So in order for us to get that spare tire that they haven't used within 6 years, 5 years, we would have to dismount it and then mount it again. Again, we are in violation of the law. Mounting, the word mount in the law gives us a hard time to refuse customers because you're not at that forefront of all the customers trying to explain to you, I just want to put it on. Just put it on for me. I don't care. Just let me have it. All I want to do is just repair the tire. All I want to do is just take my son's tires off and put it on my car because he's not using it anymore. These are the things that we deal with every single day. And in order for us to say no to a customer just because he can't repair his tire because if I mount it, I'm in violation, these are the things that we're going to keep on seeing over and over and over again. And then if you require us to do that and then we decide, no, we're not going to do it, and then we make it strict that no, we can't do it because we're going to be in violation, then later on you change your minds and then we say, okay, now we can do it. All those customers that said, oh, no, MGT just doesn't want to do it at all for us, so no, let's not go there. Lose all that business. So whether it's 6 years, 10 years, having that word there, mount, we have to mount. Dismounting requires mounting, and when you do, when you have to do that, in every scenario, whether it's a spare tire, whether it's father giving or son giving his tires to his father just because he needs tires to go, you run his car. Before, a long time ago, we had the, how many tires you want to have? Well, you just need one tire. No, I want to buy four. Now we don't have that anymore. if the tire still has 5/32 of thread left, the customer wants to use it. Oh, let me just hold that tire because I might need it later on. They save that tire. And when they save that tire, when they finally have a flat, then, you know, it just costs $1.95 to just put that tire back on, and he's on his way. But having all this kind of regulations and from the people that actually want to save money, who have that just as going from paycheck to paycheck, they're not, I mean, gone are the days of 13-inch and 14-inch. We're dealing with Toyota Corollas now come with 15-inch. There's no more $39.95 for a tire anymore. Tires are now $69.95 all the way up to, for even the Corolla, $89. And for people to now dish out that kind of money, of course they're going to be buying one at a time or trying to save up or ask their auntie, oh, you're not using those tires anymore? Okay, let me go ahead and use it because I can use it. So anytime we do a certain type of mounting, we're in violation of the law. So I just here in support of, I mean, if you really have to have this law, please understand, I mean, 6 to 10 years, how many people on Guam keep their cars for how long? My mom has a 2007, she just wants to keep it. But how many times can I, if she would, how many miles did it have? Only has 4,500 miles on a 2007. I mean, the thread is still perfect. Rotation, okay, you do that. And it lasts longer. The main thing on all of this is that, I mean, you're trying to restrict people from trying to save and get that extra mileage out of that tire. And this is the things that we're going to be seeing. So thank you very much for having us speak on this issue.
Thank you for joining us today, sir. We also have Mr. Jeff Jones, sir.
Good morning, Chairman and Vice Chairman, members of the committee. We do support this bill, and I provided a copy of our original letter to Senator Respicio when the tire dealers signed off, as well as the executive summary from the U.S. Department of Transportation NHTSA report. And originally the current law is 6 years, and it does create quite a burden on both the tire dealers as well as the customers. And as Vince mentioned, is that there's often customers that are coming into the store with the repair, and you dismount the tire, repair it, and then you realize that this tire is 7 years old. You can't put it back on the rim. Otherwise, we're in violation of the law. And so it occurs regularly. And so now, because we check before we repair them and tell them we can't repair it, which causes a confrontation, of course, with the customer because they don't understand why that exists and what the law is for when the tire is still good. But in any event, so when I contacted Senator Respicio, the intent was to have the law extended to 10 years rather than 6 years. We thought that would be a better solution, even though NHTSA actually doesn't recommend an aging requirement at all. In fact, in the summary, they mention that it says here, at this time, the agency does not believe it's necessary for motor vehicle safety to add tire aging requirements to its light vehicle and tire standard due to the following reasons. And it lists them. We've highlighted them for you in your copies there. You can see it. So this is kind of a balance because the senator felt like there was some consumer protection aspect there for the customers and the consumers having some kind of limitation. And so we discussed it and said, well, okay, 10 is reasonable. And for most, in most cases, 10 years, the tire is probably going to be worn out or it's going to be, not any good anymore. And so for that reason, there is some concern about mounting and I'm not sure what we can do about that, but I think that the 4 extra years is going to give us a lot more flexibility, and we won't face that as often with a 10-year-old tire as with a 6-year-old tire. So that's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We also have Mr. Mike McCarty.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Vice Chairman of the committee, I'm speaking here in favor of the amendment, and I'm not well known here on Guam. I've been here a little more than 2 years, and I'm the general manager of Triple J Commercial Tire. And I began my career in the tire industry in 1968 as a tire technician. those years, I've attended many courses and classes with at the Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company and Michelin Corporation. The last 20 plus years, I've spent most of my career as a tire field engineer for global mining companies and global tire manufacturers. I've done that on five continents and over 24 countries. One of my primary functions as a tire field engineer was to evaluate tires that had been removed from service to determine the cause of failure. I have examined and evaluated literally thousands and thousands of tires over those years to determine failure cause. And there are some primary things that cause tires to fail that we're all aware of. The number one is they wear out. You don't need an expert to tell you that. The second most common thing to cause a tire to fail is a road hazard. So a road hazard can be something in the road or the road itself, anything from a nail to a pothole. When tires are damaged by road hazards, they can sometimes fail, or blow out is the term commonly used, immediately. Oftentimes the tire structure is damaged by the hazard and doesn't fail immediately. Many times the damage is internal and cannot be seen outside the tire. The next most common cause of tire failure in a tire that is not worn out is tire maintenance. Over time, tires lose air. Once the tire pressure drops below the correct pressure by 8 to 12%, structural damage is going to begin in the tire itself. This is due to overflexing caused by underinflation. Overloading causes the same condition. The overflexing causes heat buildup. Heat is, as described earlier, is the tire's enemy. When we talk about tires operating at high temperatures in states like southern part of Arizona, Texas, New Mexico, those tires are operating at highway speeds under heavier loads than what normally is seen here on Guam. The load capacity of a tire changes with speed. So to use a simple example, a tire that is rated at 82 miles an hour top speed that has a carrying capacity of 3,000 pounds, the carrying capacity of that tire at 45 miles an hour is more than double that. And if you think of it in these terms, if I were to put my hand on the desk and ask Mr. Jones to lay a 16-pound bowling ball on it, the structure of my hand would easily support that 16-pound bowling ball. But if he were to lift it up 10 feet and drop that 16-pound bowling ball on my hand, the structure of my hand would fail. It's the same thing with the tire. The tire is actually, as it rolls, it's actually hitting the road forcibly. The tire is changing from circular to flat. Heat is generated at that point. Force is generated at that point. Here on the tires that are built in for United States roads are built to travel at sustained high speeds at maximum load. There's nowhere on Guam that you can come anywhere near that type of durability standard for tires that are imported here. Every tire here is DOT standard. So the failure rate, according to the tire manufacturers, of new tires due to workmanship and material defects in North America is about 2.5%. And I'm just using the major manufacturers, the names you're aware of, Goodyear, Bridgestone, Michelin, those people. So they're suffering that type of loss in the United States. My experience here on Guam has been far less than that. Since my coming to work for Mr. Jones in April of 2012, our store has sold over 50,600 passenger tires. During that time, we've had to replace 22 tires for workmanship and material defects, tires that have failed because of what the manufacturer did or the materials he used. That brings that percentage for defective tires here on Guam to much, much less than 1%. Actually, it's 0.00043, which is equivalent to one tire for about every 2,300 sold. And I can tell you that probably 22 of those tires that I replaced under warranty, I did so because a jump ball. It was not certain whether the damage was caused by road hazard, poor maintenance, or the tire manufacturer itself. We always err on the side of the customer at Triple J. The National Transportation Safety Administration, as Jeff referenced, in March of 1974, published a summary of their study and concluded that the agency does not believe it's necessary for a tire aging requirement in the United States. And I totally agree with that factor. Tire age is a factor in structural integrity of the tire, but the integrity of the tires that are coming here on Guam is so so much in excess of what the tire is going to ever be used for on Guam, the consumers are the one that are hurt most because we can't replace their tires. And another commercial problem that comes up quite frequently is somebody buys a new set of tires for their very nice car, and the tires are 2 years old when they're installed or 3 years old when they're installed. They're only driving a couple thousand miles a year. They have a flat, and they bring the car in and want to get the tire replaced, and they're in perfect condition. Our technicians are certified by the Tire Industry Association, global association for certifying tire technicians. They know how to inspect a tire. They know how to look at a tire. They can tell if there's age damage, whether there's road damage when they take that tire apart. But under current Guam law, we have to replace that tire. Now, oftentimes, the exact tire that is not available. So we're asking somebody to put on a new tire of a different brand that doesn't match the other three tires on the car perfectly. That in itself creates more safety hazard than repairing a tire that's partially worn and over age. The stopping traction and the cornering traction of every tire is slightly different. So if we take a brand new tire and put it on the front of your Lexus or your Land Rover, and across the axle from that is a half-worn tire of a different brand and a different make, and you slam on the brakes, the tire on the one side is going to give you more braking traction than the tire on the other. If you're driving through wet conditions, which is all the time here this time of year, if you were to hit a puddle with 2 inches of water in it, the tire that has brand new tread is going to disperse water much more efficiently than the tire at half tread, and the vehicle is going to want to swerve in the direction of the tire that's half tread. I really think the law created more problems than it solved, and I think the law should be repealed completely. With regard to commercial tires used on the trucking companies, those tires are far more durable than anything that goes on a passenger tire. The structures of those tires is all steel, whereas passenger tires, it's fabric, it's polyester. So trucking companies, and normally it's not an issue with them, but oftentimes they have, especially some of the government companies, have vehicles that are used very irregularly, trailers and things like that. And they bring the tires in some trailer that hasn't even been on the road for a year, and we can't fix the tire on it. So it creates more problems than it solves. I understand the compassion of not wanting anybody to be injured in an accident, but I can't, all the tires I've looked at that have come off vehicles here on Guam, I've never seen one yet that have failed due to aging. So I'm in favor of not just this amendment, but actually repealing the law altogether.
Thank you very much, Mr. McCarty. I guess just I had a few questions I wanted to ask first, just to clarify. From my perspective, I think that there's two different things that we're looking at here. We're looking at the idea that just over the passage of time, the tire is going to degrade, versus the idea that over the passage of time, the tire is going to be utilized at a rate that's going to degrade to the point where it should be replaced. Now, based on what's being shared by the Transportation Safety Administration, their findings are that with respect to passenger vehicles, the passage of time has no correlation to whether or not the tire itself is being worn down at a rate that it needs to be replaced.
They're saying that there's no scientific evidence or proof from their conclusion based on their study that tire aging is resulting in a significant amount of injuries or accidents.
But the more tire is used, the more worn down it does become.
Yes, true.
And eventually the tire does need to be replaced.
Right.
And so I think that's where I'm trying to reconcile this aging issue, because of course I can totally understand rubber. I mean, gosh, that lasts forever, you know. So just because it's old doesn't mean that it's no longer usable. But the amount of wear and tear that any particular tire has undertaken is determined based on how often it's used, not necessarily based on how old it is. I mean, if a tire is used, 24 hours a day for 5 years, of course it's going to be more worn down than a tire used in the exact same conditions, only for 12 hours a day in the same area. So I think that the whole point of the aging is to try and catch those tires that are being eventually worn down to the point where they do present a road hazard. Because there's no way for us to be able to track the usage, the actual use or wear and tear of the tire as much as there is assume a certain rate of use based on that age?
Yeah, I think one of the things to understand is that the consumers are gonna replace them when they no longer work, right? And so when their tires are being used frequently and the actual wear and tear is causing problems for them, then they come in and get them replaced. If the problem is when the wear and tear does not cause them to wear down, and they have them for 7 or 8 years, and there's a lot of people who drive their car to the store and drive it back home, especially older people, and that's all they do. And it's not uncommon to have, to only have 2,000 or 3,000 miles on the car in a year, because that's the way they go to church, they come home, they go to the store and come home, and they don't drive around a lot. And those folks, are the ones that the tires don't wear out before they age. And so I think the ones that are being used regularly, they're going to wear out way before 6 years. I mean, we're replacing tires, every 3 or 4 years for people who are driving every day, and they just wear out, and people realize they don't. They don't grip anymore, or they have a flat or whatever, and they realize it's time to repair it.
Let's say like a tire wears out over time and to the point where it is no longer usable. Now, I know that there's certain various road conditions where if it gets a flat, then of course the air leaks out of the tire, etc. But at what point would an old tire degrading to its no longer usable life be a road hazard? When it blows on the road and at a fairly high rate of speed, and then at what point would a tire reach that condition, and what's the likelihood of it reaching that condition before it's actually caught due to the normal wear and tear and someone coming in and fixing a flat and everyone saying, hey, look, this tire is about to blow, you should just replace it? I think that's what this whole aging thing is trying to catch, just trying to prevent car tires from reaching that aging point, having escaped all of the various variables that could have caused it to get caught earlier, reaching that aging point where it just actually blows and becomes a road hazard.
I think one of the issues that was originally addressed with aging is not necessarily car tires that are on cars, but tires that haven't been sold and have been sitting in warehouses aging. I think that was part of the issue, was that we don't want the tire dealers to sell these old tires, and they're 8 years old, they've been sitting in a warehouse somewhere, and then they come out and put them on a car, and then they drive and have an accident. And I think that was the original intent of the law. Was the selling old tires rather than tires that are already on the people's cars that are aging. So I think that's the original intent of the law, not trying to regulate the tires that are already on cars, because those are going to wear out eventually. I think that the individual who has a 6 or 7 year old tire on their car that they want to keep is an exception and not the rule, because most people drive their car much more than that, and they're replacing their tires much more frequently than that.
Yes, and Mr. Chairman, I'm talking from personal experience, because I've not been in the tire business ever, but I've bought tires for over 30 years now, and they do get to the point where the tire technician will say, I can't fix this tire anymore. It won't hold any more air. And I've gotten to the point too where I've seen gotten down to where you can see the belt. Whether it was a metal belt because I got poked by it, or this fabric belt that he described earlier. So there's going to be a point in time where a tire, I think, will just not be repairable anymore.
And the only reason why I'm asking these questions is because with respect to the testimony that says we shouldn't have any aging period, I see it as almost like a attached provision where, in the event that somebody is driving that tire that actually does need to be replaced, and they're just constantly repairing it over and over again, and then it gets to the point where it's going to blow. I mean, is that something that we need to worry about, really? I mean, if we're going to be able to prevent,
I think that's why Senator Respicio said, well, eliminating it might be a bigger problem than just extending the time. So, we'd like for it to go away, but in lieu of that, 10 years is acceptable.
Okay. And that's kind of what I wanted to get to. And maybe we can eventually work to that point. But I guess the incremental step would be a 10-year extension versus a 6-year.
Well, if I may, the tires wear at a fairly rapid rate here because of the coarseness of the highways. And so it's not usually an issue where something gets really, really old. We have lots and lots of tires every day that we take off that are over 6 years old. The only thing that's wrong with them is the tread's gone. to address your issue, your question about road hazard damage, if road hazard damage is introduced into a brand new tire the first day you put it on, and the damage goes down to the steel belts, which are just below the tread, and water gets in there and salt gets in there from the atmosphere here, that tire is going to fail at absolutely the same rate as a tire that's 6 years old. Rust migration through the steel belts due to an impact of some type or a cut of some type is going to be identical in a 10-year-old tire as it is in a brand new one.
Okay. Thank you. Senator Adam.
I had asked the Attorney General to come in because I'm wondering if this bill even hits the mark that we're wanting to hit. First of all, it's citing that we're going to amend Section 3218, and 3218 simply says that the applicability of Article 3 applies to government-owned vehicles, but it's actually Article 3219 that deals with tire safety. The other thing is that it seems that what we're all honing in on is this idea, because I imagine a lot of vendors, I mean, if they haven't cleared out their inventory in 5 years, they're either going to have a fire sale or something and get rid of those things. But it seems like it's really more the problem of I bring in my 8-year-old tire to be repaired and you can't. But I don't see anything in the law that says that, because Article 3219A says the sale of tires older than 6 years is prohibited. That's what we're trying to amend. Now we're trying to extend that out to 10 years.
There's a mounting provision.
Then the second paragraph says all sellers, vendors, distributors shall provide a written statement of the date of the manufacturer of the tires being sold. And then a paragraph C is that each retailer must post a sign, a statement, so big and all that, saying, warning, aged tires can fail, and that even with little or no use, tires older than 6 years may not be sold or mounted for use on vehicles. But that's a requirement to be put on that statement. There's nothing in the law that says you cannot repair or mount. So, and so, I don't know, maybe this is where the AG needs to take a look at, are we even hitting the mark with this bill?
Well, our interpretation was that we couldn't repair or mount it.
Well, that's what has to be in the statement. There's nothing in the law that says you cannot.
In the placard, I think, was the...
On the
that's you where may not.
Says, yeah.
You may not.
On 3219, penalties, any person who knowingly sells a tire or mounts a tire on a vehicle is in violation of 3218 of this chapter commits a third-degree felony.
Prohibition is you cannot sell tires older than 6 years. You're required to provide written statements of the date of manufacture, and you are required to post a statement saying that tires get old and all that stuff, and that tires older than 6 years may not, says you cannot or you shall not, be sold or mounted for use on vehicles. And then, okay, penalties, any person who knowingly sells a tire or mounts on a vehicle is in violation of 3219. So I have a feeling that I'm just concerned, Mr. Chairman, that, you know, this bill, probably more from a technical standpoint, construction, I agree with the concerns that have been raised, that the guy that's really going to get hit is probably the guy who's going to hold on to that tire for as long as he has, and after 6 years old, I can't even get it repaired. So anyway, I just raised that as an issue.
Thank you, Senator Adams. I see the point where the previous section there kind of implies the industry with the May language has the professional expertise to be able to determine whether or not the tire is still usable for the consumer, but then for the government to turn around and create the penalty as a result. go ahead and work on that, and I appreciate the testimony with respect to the mounting. And thank you, Senator Atta, for pointing out the inconsistencies there in those two sections. Any other senators had any questions for the panel? I did want to state one thing for the record here, and this was with respect to a written testimony that we received concerning trucks and buses radial tires, TBR tires. And this is probably an amendment where we might want to put into the language of the bill, because the way it's written, it says the sale of tires older than 6, and it's now amended to say 10 years for use on vehicles operated on the highways and roadways of Guam, is prohibited except for TBR tires, trucks and buses radial tires. Now that might actually be misinterpreted to read that trucks and buses radial tires older than 10 years may continue to be operated on the highway. So we're going to just tighten it up and say TBR tires, which shall be limited to 6 years. Is there any objection from anybody present on the TBR tires?
The TBR should be eliminated from the law completely.
That's the exception.
To eliminate TBR tires from the law.
I think that's what they meant in that. To eliminate the TBR.
So this is what we need to have a discussion on then. So we're not concluded yet, because I have received testimony here from another service provider that states that in regards to the tires for trucks and buses, commonly known as TBR tires, there have been no studies or data reported showing that these tires last longer or are more safe to use on the roads. The reports that were provided by the Department of Transportation National Highway Traffic Safety Administration were solely in respect to passenger automotive tires and did not include any testing of truck and bus tires. I don't see a reason to change current law in regards to TBR to make these more usable, to make these usable longer than 6 years. They were longer than the 6 years they were designed for. Trucks and buses on Guam generally don't use tires for more than 2 years on the road, if even close to that length of time. Generally, tires get replaced every 6 months to a year. The regulations that are in place for these tires are strict because of the loads they carry, such as heavy materials for construction, liquids or other chemicals such as gasoline, our tourists, or even our school children. Remember that the vehicles that use these tires also operate on the same roads we use every day. Please take this into consideration, and please, of course, let us know your thoughts. And so when I read this section here, I wasn't sure if the intent was to keep TBR at 6 and passenger vehicle at and increase passenger vehicle to 10. But now my understanding is that the intent is to eliminate TBR entirely and only have passenger at 10. Could we get some commentary on that? Because based on this testimony here, I'm not a tire expert, but load-bearing tires, you know, those kind of things, I would like to hear what the panel has to offer on that. Carl, what do you mean?
Mr. Chairman, I called Senator Respicio's office yesterday and asked the staff what those words mean, and her reply was that TBRs would not be included, meaning they could go past 10 years. They fit, you know, there would be no time limit on TBRs. That was the explanation that was given to me.
Okay. Any other gentleman wish to comment?
Yeah, let me just jump in on the TBR durability issue. It's standard practice in North America for trucking companies, the large long-haul trucking companies, to operate their trucks 22 hours a day. Team drivers at highway speeds. The major rubber companies have developed their own retreading systems so that the tires, once they wear out, they retread them numerous times. And I think the last report I read was a major trucking company like Roadway or Old Dominion was getting somewhere around 700,000 miles out of the original tire carcass over multiple treads. And it's not unheard of to get 1 million on those trucking companies. Now, I would just say those are the same basic tires that are being used here. Some of them come from different companies, but in different manufacturing plants, but they all are built to the same standards that are going into those trucking fleets in the U.S. that are operating under those conditions. And I would just say the tires are so overbuilt for what can ever be done with them here. There's just no way to load those tires, use those tires in any way near to do any damage to the structure of those tires in 6 years. Because of aging. I mean, there's no scientific study that supports that anywhere that I can find. The industry experts that I talked to said there's never been a study done in a chemical analysis. You know, the chemist can prove that there's been been minor changes in the molecular structures, but there's been no proof of what that change does. It's so minuscule. And that's why there's never been a test done in the United States with TBR tires, is because it's just not needed.
Well, they have to be able to retread them, and they couldn't continue to retread them and use them if there was a 6-year life. So they, you know, they retread tires, truck tires, multiple times, especially the better brands. And if there was a 6-year limit, then they'd be out of business, really, because they retread them, you know, as many times as they can and continue to use them. Who was that testimony from?
This was submitted from United Tire. Yeah, it's part of the record that we received in the email.
Okay. Well, they also signed off on the. You guys also signed off on the testimony that we.
Yes, I understand. I'm just, asking the clarification, because if we're saying that 10 years is something that would be suitable for a light vehicle, why are we not going to have any kind of yearly limitation on a much heavier vehicle with varying load bearings? I mean, it was even mentioned that it's the consistency of the wear on the tire that has a lot to do with aging. And when you're talking about, for example, a dump truck that has various weight capacities, you know, going over. I mean, if you just drive Route 4 or Southern Roads, I mean, those road conditions, you know, and then to say that, you know, we're going to have a light vehicle tire replaced every 10 years, but a much heavier load-varying vehicle not getting replaced at all, or at least not having a timeline at all, I'm just trying to reconcile that.
I think the road conditions would create road hazards, which would cause the tires to fail prior to 6 years. So we're not really addressing road hazard, because you can have a brand new tire that when you pull out of the tire dealer becomes unusable because of a road hazard, pothole, whatever. So those are going to be that's going to happen regardless of the any year standard that you apply. But I think the reason why we didn't address it is because nowhere in the industry do they talk about a year limitation on TBR.
So but they do talk about it for the
passenger light truck. That's why there was a study done, is because there was a question.
But there hasn't been any study done on TBR tires to validate it one way or the other?
I don't know of any. I searched the internet recently to see if there's something new.
Yeah. Okay. So, yeah, we'll Senator Lubchenco, please.
I can understand the concern, but currently we're not retreading any of the TBR tires on Island, right? So the useful
TBR tires are shipped off for retreading and then re-imported.
Right, but we currently do any of the sold tires.
Well, they can't be sold as new, but they're sold as retreads. So
yeah, okay. I think that's the concern there.
Okay, so maybe what we'll do is, I mean, since we've pretty much reconciled that the National Highway Transportation Safety Administration has specifically made clear statements with respect to passenger vehicles, we can probably move that one forward comfortably, and we'll probably keep the status quo on the TBR tires until such time that we get some other additional information that will allow us to make a determination there. But I wouldn't want to hold up the entire bill because we're not sure about the TBR side. So perhaps the committee will go ahead and move forward on the passenger vehicle side, and then at a later date we can get more information concerning the TBR tires based on whatever information is out there available. Senator Adam.
I just have one question, and probably the AG is probably better suited to address this. And I noticed that in the penalties that anybody who knowingly sells a tire or mounts a tire on a vehicle in violation of 3219 commits a third-degree felony. And again, this goes back to my earlier question in another bill, where in order for a criminal offense to be prosecuted, it has to go through the AG's office. And so, I mean, so this almost becomes like really a law with no teeth on it, you know, because that's for sure, yeah. I mean, so it just kind of puts a, you know, make it ridiculous, I guess, so to speak. So, yeah, okay, fine. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Adams. Thank you, gentlemen, members of the panel, for joining us and participating today. We will take all of those This takes us to our last item on the agenda, which is bill number 413. This bill has been introduced by Senator Limtiaco, and I'll at this time go ahead and yield to the author for his opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Chair, bill 14 is a version of prior introduced and heard on the floor bill 362. And the only difference between these two bills are the sections two of which, or excuse me, sections three, which look to make the change in statute of limitation from 30 years to 10 years be for those years after 2013. So the bills are much are very similar. Except for mainly that section. Other than that, most of the other parts of the bill have been heard at the prior hearing on Bill 362. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Senator Limtiaco. We do have two written testimonies here, one from the Department of Revenue and Taxation and one from the Guam Economic Development Authority. I understand that their representatives may also wish to testify, along with Attorney General Phil Tydenko. So if you may all please join us at the table.
Chairman Michael San Nicolas and members of the Committee on Aviation, Ground Transportation, Regulatory Concerns, and Future Generations. I'm here to present testimony in full support of Bill 413-32 as it allows for the continued collection of property taxes. The Guam Economic Development Authority supports this measure as it would allow the government of Guam to achieve full collection of property tax revenues, thus sustaining our ability to pay down current and future obligations. The new revenues from the recent property valuations will also result in additional funding and will further aid in the government of Guam's ability to provide additional resources for the Department of Education and necessary funding for critically needed repairs and renovations at our public schools. I thank you for your support for this measure and the opportunity to provide testimony in favor of Bill 413-32LS. We look forward to your favorable consideration. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. John?
Mr. Chairman, Vice Chairman, members of the committee again. My name is John Camacho. I'm Director of the Department of Revenue and Taxation. And again, I'm here in full support of the passage of Bill 413. As the author has said earlier in his opening statement, The only new ones that we're really looking at right now compared to the previous one is the statute of limitations that basically broke it down from 30 to 10 years. And this bill now is proposing a perspective to keep the 10 years, but prospectively moving forward and to keep the 30 years. So in the event that we can collect those 11 to 30 years prospectively, and each year that the statute will expire for those years. But more importantly, we're here to really ask for the full support to extend the dates, which is really what we really need in order to proceed with the revaluation values for the 2013 values that are being done right now. As you know, the revaluation started earlier this year, and it was supposed to have been completed in August 30th, just in time to meet the preliminary assessment of September 1st. We have extended the completion of this revaluation up to December 31st, which is basically in line with some of the proposed bill is basically also to extend the exemption deadlines to afford people that may qualify for the senior citizens or the disabled or other exemptions that are afforded under the law to the extent all the way up to December 31st. While we're looking into that and putting those perspective into our 2014 in anticipation of the completion of our revaluation by December 31st, we're also looking at other deadlines that we're trying to extend on this particular bill, which is to extend the preliminary assessment again to February 2nd, as well as to basically extend the period for filing appeals in the event that the landowners feel aggrieved and disagree with the revaluation. So these, you know, are extended. And again, by March 31st, we're looking at, the possibility of the Board of Equalization meeting before that date to certify the revaluation dates for that 2014. In line with that, also, we fully support basically the requiring the owners to disclose their social security as well as EIN numbers for future purposes. Right now, it's basically a voluntary from the taxpayers to come in and have their refunds automatically offset against their real property tax. By having this law requiring these landowners to come in and disclose their social security, it'll be an automatic offset, just like any receivables, whether it's income tax, GRT, or whatever. It is very important that we look at this thing, and we really need to extend the dates. Otherwise, we won't meet the deadline for the 2014. As we're looking at this additional anticipation of additional revenue for the Department of Revenue, Department of Education, which is the Territorial Educational Facility Fund, increase in collection. And with that, I really want to ask for your support in passing this bill.
Thanks, John. Before I go over to Deputy Chief, I wanted to just quickly ask, are people still coming in and trying to apply for these exemptions? And are you accepting the applications pending change of the law, or are you just rejecting them and sending
yes,
them
no. Any exemption application is accepted as the date they filed. If the law were to pass, we're going to include all these people, because if you filed after the deadline, which is I believe March 15, it'll be applicable for the following year.
Okay, so you're just banking the applications,
yes,
pending whatever the final outcome of the law is.
Yes,
very good. Okay, thank you, Deputy Chief Tedinko.
Thank you, Phil Tedinko, on behalf of Office of Attorney General. Yeah, we also urge senators to support this bill, and I believe it's necessary. It was necessary to have this bill be enacted because we thought it required a law in order to extend these deadlines. It couldn't do it administratively, so we think this is a good fix for doing that and accommodating the reevaluations. Thank you.
Thank you. Do any senators have any questions for this panel? This is very, very important. I'm very glad to know that you guys are banking the applications. So the committee will firmly commit to making sure that this is on the legislative agenda for our December session and passed summarily with the support of our colleagues. But this will be reported out post haste. Any other questions or comments for the bill? Any senators have any other comments? Senator Giacco, would you like to close?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just want to thank the panel for coming in and testifying on behalf of it. I want to also thank the original author of this bill, Senator Sir Nicholas, because most of the items that are contained in Bill 14 are of the origin of Bill 362. And, as we were discussing Bill 362 on the floor, one of the concerns that I had brought up were the effects of the Terrell Education Fund. And I want to thank the chairman as well as the author of Bill 362 for supporting the bill, and we look forward to passing it. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Limtiaco. And just a quick clarification. So if we have this passed in the December session, that's going to be okay for the Department of Revenue Taxation?
Yes, that's correct, Mr. Chairman. The preliminary assessment would give us the authority to issue it on or before February 2nd.
Okay, so we'll make our commitment to have it on the agenda.
Yes,
thank you, John. This will go ahead and conclude all the items that we have on the agenda for today's hearing. Any additional testimonies may be submitted to senatorsnicholas@gmail.com or dropped off to the Guam Legislature main building. 155 Hester Place, Agatnya, Guam. We'll go ahead and adjourn this hearing at 11:50 this morning. Thank you, everybody, for your participation.